Yeah, that works. Good morning to you too. So go ahead and stand up and stretch your legs as we begin our worship in this amazing room with yes and amen. Reflect on the foundation of our faith in our lives. gather together around the candle of peace.
The home we long for is a home that knows peace.
Peace and the rest between us and our grief.
Peace around our anxiety.
Peace between us and ourselves.
Peace at the core of our being.
Peace hovering through and in our world.
The home we long for is the home we know that means peace.
So today we light a candle of peace as a reminder and as a prayer. Let it be so.
Well, second Sunday of Advent, Sunday of Peace. Our hope is that as we worship together, that we would be filled with the reminder of God's peace in our lives. I see that we're all very spread out today. Probably, maybe some of you know this isn't obvious, but today we're having our cocoa apparel event. We're going to need all these tables then. So that's what they're there for. I hope you come back for us then. Good to see you here today. Let's pray together as we continue with worship. Holy God, we give thanks for this reminder with the little advent candle that we arrive in closer to Christmas, this day of celebration where you showed up dramatically in the course of human history. And we speak about our longing for that to happen again, in little and big ways. And one of the words that we use to mark this time of year is this desire for peace, peace in our lives, in our world, our communities. And yet we know that we desire it because we have longing for it. We can see places where there is unrest, there is unpeace. We know that feeling. We know it very well. So, Lord, as we gather today on this second Sunday of Advent, may we think, may we lift up that unrest we feel, and may we hope and pay attention to ways in which you are
And Emmanuel means?
God with us.
God with us, yes. But it also means you can't turn on your microphone. Yes. The Emmanuel.
The with us God. Emmanuel with us El God. Emmanuel. God is with us. Our scripture lesson this morning comes to us from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 3. This is the beginning of the proclamation of John the Baptist. Would it really screw things up too badly if I asked, could you bring that slide back up of John the Baptist? The guy spouting love. Yeah, there you go. Thank you. This was on the bulletin at the first service this morning. Every family has a crazy Uncle John. Now, if you have a crazy Uncle John in your family, the wild man from Borneo, the one you don't want to sit next to the guest at the family gathering, that uncle, right? John the Baptist is our Uncle John. But it's important to note that John is bringing us good news. It may be hard to take sometimes, but John is bringing us words of love. Thank you. If you could pull that back to the scripture lesson, that would be good. Thank you very much. That was totally unplanned, by the way. So, hands off. Applause to the wonderful slides presenter. Thank you. John the Baptist is present in all four of the Gospels. Each of the Gospels looks at J.D. a little bit differently. And it's worth going back. He's right at the beginning of all three Gospels. In fact, much of Luke chapter 1 is devoted to the circumstances of the birth of John the Baptist. And they really are worth going back and looking at this afternoon. Let me say two things about this text as it comes to us from Luke. You'll notice it's going to begin with a history lesson. In the 15th year of Emperor Tiberius, which is going to be about 28-29 AD. Not really sure exactly, but about 28-29 AD. What Luke is doing here is he is fixing this event in time. In time and in place. This is not some mythical thing that happened long ago. This is not, you know, the sword and the stone and the once and future king and all of that business. No, this is when God intervened in human history in the 15th year of the reign of the Emperor Tiberius in this specific place. And also, there's going to be a lot being said here about road construction. Let's remember, in the ancient world, the road was the nearest cow path, right? The Roman legions were famous for building roads, but they were the only ones who were famous for building roads. Roads were just whatever path happened to be created. A royal highway would have been, you know, a moderately maintained county dirt road. And so when you have an important person with all of their entourage coming to a community, you want to make sure that the road is sufficient to handle them. And this is difficult to do because you don't have caterpillar. You've got very flimsy shovels at best that you're working with. So it takes a lot of effort to straighten out the road, fill it in, build a bridge, that kind of thing. So bear that in mind. As we look at this text today, coming to us from John chapter 3. In the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, okay, 28-29 AD, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, we'll meet him later, when Herod, and this is the son of Herod the Great, that we read about in Matthew's Gospel. When Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip, ruler of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias, ruler of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God." Beloved, this is the good news of the Lord for us this day. Thanks be to God. Gracious Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight. We ask this in the name of our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Think for just a moment, if you would, of any person in the world today that you would be thrilled if they would call you on the phone and invite themselves to dinner with you. Anyone at all, but if they just called you up out of the blue and invited themselves to dinner, you would say, yes, yes, yes. Movie star, politician, captain of industry, world leader, favorite teacher, relative you haven't seen in decades. Think of anybody you can think of that you would just be thrilled if they would call out of nowhere and invite themselves to have dinner. I would be thrilled beyond words to meet this lady. Anybody? She's fairly obscure here. This is Miranda Hart. Miranda Hart is a British comedian and actress, late 40s, 50s, something like that. If you watch PBS, if you've ever seen the show Call the Midwife, she has been on Call the Midwife for a while. Some years ago, she had a popular television show on the BBC called Miranda Hart Show, H-A-R-T. If you like British humor, and I like British humor, go look it up on YouTube. She is absolutely hilarious. But another thing about Miranda Hart, I mean, she's not just a very fine comedian and actress, and she doesn't wear this on her sleeve. She is also a very devout Christian. And she has written quite moving about love, faith, grief and loss, about, you know, self-care, mental health, things like that. Just a wonderfully compassionate lady. Now, to be clear, we've never met. As far as I know, we've never even been in the same time zone. Maybe not even on the same side of the world. I don't know. I wouldn't even know how to get a hold of her by. So, if we were to have dinner, it would be because she reached out to me. She would be the one taking the gracious initiative to call me and invite herself to dinner. And if she did, I would be thrilled beyond words. Like I said, my wife knows about this, by the way. This is not a secret that I'm letting you in on. In fact, she sent me something from Miranda Hart's Facebook page just this morning. Really very interesting. So, if we were to meet, it would be at her initiative. So you've thought about this person. who it is that you would like to, why are we all on this side of the room? It's really hard to find center mass. You guys are spread out like this, okay. This person has called and invited us to come, invited themselves to come and have dinner with us. What are we going to do until this individual arrives? Are we going to sit, twiddle our thumbs, stare at the calendar? Well, no, of course not. We're going to get ready, aren't we? We are going to prepare. We're going to clear our own calendar to make sure that we're not double booked. We're going to clear our calendar and make sure we have time to be with this person who has so graciously invited themselves to come and dine with us. We're probably going to need a little cleaning, dust, vacuum. You know, pick up the dirty clothes out of the center of the floor, find the extra guest chair, things like that. Buy the food we're going to need. Prepare as much as we can in advance. I would go out and pick up trash from around my apartment building. You might spruce up your lawn, get the kids' bikes out of the driveway. Maybe park the car somewhere else so there's plenty of room in front. All good things to do. But why? Why are we working so hard? I mean, Miranda already invited herself to dinner. I didn't do it. Why go through all this preparation? Well, for one thing, it's a sign of respect. Right? It's a sign of respect. And the more preparation we do ahead of time, the more incentive we have to make sure that the evening goes well. And two, the more preparation we do, the more we're liable to enjoy the evening together. We're going to be more relaxed and able to enjoy each other if we have cleaned the house, found the guest chair, done all that sort of preparatory work. But regardless of how much work we do, eventually the meal is going to come to an end, isn't it? Miranda Hart will finish dinner, and she will get up, and she will leave. Now, I'm sure she will be very British and say, Ken, oh, I have had such a lovely time, and you really must come to London and visit me, and I will say, oh, it's been entirely my pleasure, Miranda. Thank you so very much. I do wish you would stay. Oh, I would love to, but I'm sorry I can't. Because she couldn't stay. She would have other places to go, things to do. Besides which, it would be kind of weird, not to mention inappropriate. So as much as we would enjoy our time together, and I think we would, there would still come a point where Miranda and I would shake hands, and then she would leave. Do you know where I'm going with this? Can you see where I'm going? In God, in Jesus, God has graciously reached out to us. God in Jesus has graciously shown the initiative and reached out to us and come to us. In Jesus, God has come to us. And we respond by making room in the home of our hearts. We clear our calendar. We make sure we have time to spend with God during the day. We pick up all those bad habits that are cluttering our lives, and we push them out so that God has room to sit. We scrub all the stains from the sins of our hearts. So God has a pleasant place to live. In Jesus, God has come to us. And we respond by preparing, by making room in our lives for God. And so in Jesus, we meet God over and over and over again. You see, that meal with the celebrity is going to end. And then that person is going to get up and go. But in Jesus, God doesn't leave. In Jesus, God stays with us. In Jesus, God comes to us constantly. You know, meeting Jesus, meeting God in Jesus is not a one and done. It's a constant recurring activity. And so every day then, every day we are able to meet God anew in Jesus. And it's so important then that every day we make room for God. That every day we clear out the clutter in our spiritual lives. And we work on cleaning up the place so that we can be with God and enjoy God being with us. Friends, this is the good news of the gospel. This is the message of the church, the message of our faith, the message that we share with the world, that God has graciously chosen in Jesus Christ to come and be with us, not just once, not just one meal, but again and again and again. And we respond to this good news by opening up our lives and letting God be a part of us. And so today, we rejoice that God in Jesus has come to us in this table. God has come to us. Thanks be to God. Let us dine.
Well, Ken already gave a great introduction or invitation to communion, but I guess I'll share with them as well. In this season of Advent, it means something like arrival or coming. It's a season where we celebrate the coming of God into our lives and the world. And so in communion, we celebrate this very tangibly. We celebrate the very presence of God given for us, and we consume it and we let it nourish our bodies. What's interesting about the season of Advent, I feel like we have to explain this every year, because I think sometimes we all get trapped into the idea that Christmas is really about a day 2,000 years ago. It is. It's about then, but actually the season of Advent, I think, at least from my understanding, is a lot more about the future. That we're celebrating the coming of Christ, the hopeful coming of Christ into our lives and world. That's why I think in this season, this time of year, we get all those sort of questions that start to bubble up in us. About like, oh, I can't wait until. Won't it be so great when? Because that's the proclamation of the desire for God to come back into our world. And so because that is the thing we're celebrating, we often look back to the birth of Christ. And we can identify with the people who were living just before that time, with all that sort of anticipation and preparation that they were doing. Identify with their language, because here we are 2,000 years later longing for something like that to happen again. And so there's an old tradition in liturgy when we do the prayer of communion that says Christ has come, Christ will come, or has come, sorry, Christ has come, Christ is coming, Christ will come again. And I think we celebrate that very much during this season of Advent. I encourage you to say it with me if you would, as Christ has come, Christ is coming. Christ will come again. Can you say it with me? Try it. Christ has come. Christ is coming. Christ will come again. Let's celebrate that point. Pray for that. Holy God, we give thanks for you the ruler of the universe and giver of every good gift. For the sun, the moon, the stars in their order of orbit. You have given us this beautiful world in which to live. You have given us the loved ones in our lives. You have given us the breath in our lives. And so we praise you for all of the gifts that you have given to us. And we give thanks especially during this season, but especially always during this meal, for the gift of Christ, who, when the moment was right, put on flesh and dwelt among us and was full of grace and truth and showed us your love. Showed us your way of healing and care and redemption, forgiveness, salvation. We give thanks for the witness of your life in human form so that we can see it most fully. Holy God, we also give thanks for the gift of this Holy Spirit that you give to us. And that we would pray and descend upon this meal, this bread, and this cup, so that it might unite us with you. It might unite us together and unite us in mission to the world. And it's in this prayer of desire for union in this community that we practice it by praying for each other, especially those in need. We pray for the Knight family. Jesse Knight's going to have back surgery here next week. Susan Guzman also emailed and asked us to pray for Regina, her daughter, who's 7 months pregnant and has COVID. We pray for the Hortman family as they mourn the loss of Charisse's mother, Carol. We pray for Mary Christian, who also passed away suddenly a week. Lord, we also give thanks for the people around this room, the tables. We give thanks to see Joel back playing the bass, recovering from his finger injury. We give thanks to see the Smiths over there, your baby Trevor making some noise. I'm so lucky to have him here. Lord, again, we pray that this body and cup would be the body of Christ to us, and that would feed us and nourish us, so that we could then be the body of Christ to the world. Give thanks for this day, this meal, this people. Amen. So it was that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, that he took a loaf of bread. And after giving thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples. And he said, "Take this, eat of it, all of you. Do this in remembrance of me. This is my body given for you." And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant which is sealed in my blood and shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Take this, all of you, drink of it. Do this in remembrance of me." And so it is that every time we eat this bread and we drink from this cup, that we proclaim the saving death of our risen Lord until he comes again. Maybe in this very moment. Amen. If you, like me, left your big rubber cup or left it over here, now's the time to get one, or you can get it after the service if you would like. Take the cracker and celebrate the body of Christ. We take the fruit of the vine and we celebrate the cup of salvation poured out for us. Let's pray. Holy God, we would ask that this very meal would strengthen us, not just with calories, but with your very spirit. Power moving in our lives and remind us reminding us again and again of your very real present, your very real advent coming to us each and every day. And unite us to you, unite us together, and unite us in your mission. And so taking this meal and being reminded of being called your children, we pray the prayer that you taught us to, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory of the Lord. Draw your attention to the announcements at your table there. You can take that home with you. Please do, actually, so you can maybe write them down or put them in your phone or however you can just keep track of stuff. But Cocoa and Carols is a wonderful event that we have tonight. We've got a variety of musical groups. We'll have cookies. We'll have cocoa. It'll be a wonderful time. It's right here, 5 o'clock tonight. Unless you're in one of the groups, in which case, hopefully, you know what time you're supposed to show up, right, Carissa? So please. Please come to that event. It's a great way to kick off the holidays. And to some people, you know, want to wear their best Christmas pajamas. You know, be one of those people. That's great. Or wear your Christmas best. I don't really care. But come and enjoy the time together. Also, next week, very important, we will have a congregational meeting. That will be during the service a little bit, or toward the end of the service, and there'll be enough electing the elders and deacons and a nomination. But then after that, we will also have a presentation by our ESW group, our Elder Seeking Wisdom, a good portion of our session. We have kind of a big announcement about a lot of work that they have been putting in. And so I would encourage you to put that date on your calendar and come if you can, obviously. But then if you need to, you can probably watch it online or even stream it later. Then also starting next Sunday, we will have just one service at 10 o'clock. Right? One finger, then all fingers. One service at 10 o'clock, basically through Christmas, through the end of the year. So we have a wonderful services, a bell, the bell choir will be providing a lot of music and a pageant. Christmas Eve, obviously, all different times, and then a carol sing last Sunday of December. So I encourage you to come to those services, obviously. The rest I think I could probably skip over, but script was already here today. Well, I'll get there. Sorry, yeah. Script will get is here today. If you're looking for another way to help give to Westminster and our ministries here, think about the script card table that's out there every Sunday between services. It's basically gift cards, right? So you can great stocking stuffers, great gifts, and then the church gets a portion kickback of that amount. So think about buying some of those if you need gift cards anyway. Lastly, big announcement for today is our $7,000 blessing. What do you call these? Voting. Ballots. I don't know what you call these. You guys have these? You all have them? Yes? No? One for every person. We don't care how old, whether you're a member or not. One for every person. Encourage you to fill this out and then place it in the basket in the back if you haven't done so already. Three organizations are on there, the Joe Foundation, Eye of the Yield, House of Hope. They're listed in health metaphor, not preference. We try to write them up so it was equal attention was given to each, so don't try to read into it. They're trying to provide you information about these organizations. But it's a wonderful tradition that we've had of voting for one's organizations to give them a large gift, $7,000 at the end of the year, which they can use to help them carry out their wonderful work that they're doing. Of course, we might use the word ministry. And actually, we have a video from last year's winner, just to give you a little extra motivation.
Through Caden's Closet, we physically and tangibly meet the needs of children of foster, adopted, and active military families within our community and beyond. There's clothes, shoes, and so much more. bought so many diapers. Caden's Closet, I would like to say thank you to the Westminster Presbyterian Church for your donation last December.
So the mission committee has given a portion of all of the offerings, right, we take in 10%, and then we decide often how to use that funds. And so one of the things we've been doing is putting the vote back into your hands about where it should go. So we take these nomination forms and we ask you what's an organization that you would love to see get some of these funds. And then we, you know, there's three great groups here, right? But our desire, our hope, is actually to give a large enough gift that can really make a big impact for that one. For that one group. So nothing against, you know, the ones that don't get, but we just want to have this kind of extra blessing for that one. So I encourage you to vote and fill those out and turn them in, please. We'll make that announcement for After Church Between Services. Is it tomorrow or next week?
Next Sunday.
Next Sunday we'll make the announcement. Okay. So next Sunday you'll get to hear that who was the winner, and we can all hear it together. So kind of a great thing. So I hope that's enough reason right there, just this, on why it's important to give. Thank you so much for the ways in which you give to this community so we can do wonderful things like this and provide other ministries and worship and all of those things. I know that I am lucky to have this group of people that pours out their time, money, energy, and talents so we can do these good things and hopefully bring the gifts of God to the world. Thank you. By the band, come on up and sing our closing song.
We can't send you out sitting on the chairs. So let's stand up and let's sing our closing song together. This one will get you fired up, no pun intended, but it's so on fire. Dad joke there. Thank you.
It is the one who loves us in the past, the one who loves us now, and the one who loves us in the world. So friends, take this good news out into the world and share it freely. As you do so, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord God Almighty this day of all